Hi, everyone. Welcome. Welcome to tonight's Una's lecture. I'd like to begin by thanking the Townsend staff for all their hard work in making this event possible. Rebecca Egger, Diane Sugimoto-Soper, Michaela Byrne, Eric Cotilla, Ramona Nadoff, and Jane Law. They're an extraordinarily dedicated team and great fun to work with. It's my great pleasure to welcome Bonnie Honig as this year's UNAS lecturer. The UNAS lectures were established by Edward Hunter Ross in honor of his late wife, Una Smith Ross. The UNAS endowment has been administered by the Townsend Center since 1987 and supports an annual lecture series that brings distinguished visiting scholars in the humanities to the Berkeley campus. Writing in 1969, Edward Ross would state that he hoped the UNAS lectures would, quote, aim not at providing practical advice or at improving the world, but rather at opening the individual mind, close quote, which he felt could be achieved among other means through, quote, fresh interpretations of the motives of ancient heroes and villains, close quote. His is an open-ended and non-instrumental vision that strikes the ear in our increasingly vocational times. All the same, assuming that by ancient heroes and villains, he meant the fictional ones of classical antiquity, I can think of no one more suited to deliver this year's UNAS lecture than Bonnie Honig. Bonnie is the Nancy Duke Lewis Professor of Modern Culture and Media and Political Science at Brown. Bonnie's extraordinary list of publications include The Field-Defining Political Theory and the Displacement of Politics, 1993, which received a 30th anniversary reissue this year by Cornell University Press, Antigone Interrupted, 2013, and most recently, Shell-Shocked Feminist Theory After Trump and A Feminist Theory of Refusal, both 2021. As someone who took a seminar with Julia Kristeva as an undergraduate, who learned theory from feminists such as Carol Smith Rosenberg, Betsy Urkola, and the late Linda Hart, someone who went to graduate school when advanced feminist theory was a course you could take, and who laments the waning of feminism as a rubric for theoretical inquiry, I greeted the publication of A Feminist Theory of Refusal with both relief and excitement. Honig thinks with Euripides' 5th century tragedy, The Bacchae, reading it as a drama of refusal. She invites us to look upon refusal not as a withdrawal from the world, but as a form of world building by honing in on 3 stages in that narrative's arc of refusal. First, the Bacchants' decision to flee the city of Thebes, their refusal to work in the city. Second, their establishment of a community outside the city, the Cytheron, where they live otherwise, and third, their return to the city with a set of demands. Seeing the Bacchic in everything from the sororal bond between mother and daughter in Leonardo da Vinci's The Virgin and Child with St. Anne, to the wayward inclinations of the black women and girls in Saidiya Hartman's Wayward Lives, Beautiful Experiments, Honig specifies 3 forms of refusal: inoperativity, or the suspension of activity; inclination, or the refusal of the posture of verticality for a choreography of mutuality and care; and fabulation, or the depathologizing of the misogynist and anti-black judgments of the archive, of which the Bacchae is one. The violence of Bacchae carries with it a powerful lesson, that equality requires breaking with patriarchy, breaking with those we love. The Bacchant's horrific violence, Bonnie writes, quote, shows how the breaks necessitated by equality tear us apart, rip apart loved ones, and destroy the conjugal and communal bonds we value even though they make us unequal, end of quote. Their murderous dismemberment of the king, Pentheus, quote, vivifies the fears that stop us, the reluctance to lose loved ones that renders us complicit with oppressive cultures, and the anxieties that keep us compliant with our own and others' subjugation, end of quote. With Bonnie's help, one is inclined to see even Lauren Berlant's cruel optimism as a Bacchae. As has been true since her first book, Political Theory and the Displacement of Politics, Bonnie's is a theory of agonism or agonistic virtue. the desire, as Nietzsche phrased it, to, quote, rouse enmity towards order. The commitment, Bonnie holds, to contestation for the sake of those remaindered by particular political settlements, or partage du sensible, in Rancière's phrase, distributions of what's thinkable, knowable, and with partage also meaning to share, fundamental to political participation. In stressing Aegon, Bonnie focuses our attention on the incomplete project of democracy. Quote, the hope, fear, and vulnerability of not yet, she writes, palpable when we are on the verge, which is the temporality of riot and of refusal. And unsurprisingly, Bonnie tends to draw her examples from Black culture, consonant with this stress on the not yet, the exilic, and being outside the political family circle. But the turn to Black politics, Black life, Black performance in Bonnie's work never feels arbitrary. In fact, one more often feels a sense of inevitability. So it's surprising and not that a feminist theory of refusal ends with an appendix on Muhammad Ali's repertoire of refusal, his inoperativity or refusal to be drafted in the Vietnam War, his inclination or judo-like performance in the ring, floats like a butterfly and stings like a bee, and his fabulation, his demand to be recognized as the greatest. Muhammad Ali, the movement for Black lives, we are still on the verge, Bonnie writes. Still, as Bonnie herself knows, there is another arc of refusal in the Black tradition outside the gravitational field of the struggle for recognition and equality, sometimes just outside, but more recently, far outside. Kevin Quaishie calls this more radical commitment to refusal the sovereignty of quiet, a refusal of the many ways in which Black people are over-identified with an idea of expressiveness that is geared toward a social audience and that has political aim, a refusal of resistance, of being conscripted into the roles of prophet, conscience, martyr. Frank Wilderson's Afro-pessimism is even further outside, assuming a Blackness that is anathema to the political family circle, the circle of the human as such. Blackness is the place that has no place. Or as Fred Moten asks, and this is gonna be a very Fred Moten sentence, so brace yourselves. Gotta get the tempo right. What if Blackness is the refusal to defer to, given in the withdrawal from the eternal delay of sovereignty? What is it, in other words, to think from no standpoint, to think outside the desire for standpoint? What emerges in the desire that constitutes a certain proximity to that thought? As with the Bakhans, that step outside is promising, but it is also, well, pessimistic. It is for reasons of Bonnie's long-held and persistently illuminating investments in agonism, in the commitment to contestation, that I view these moves outside of that commitment, these steps outside the demos, warily, but also deeply seriously. Your work, Bonnie, is a reminder of what we risk in accepting a practice of refusal that abandons the city without transforming it. That's me quoting you. And this is me quoting you again. It leaves in place a city in control of the material and symbolic resources it needs to vanquish its rivals. Recalling Audre Lorde, we might think again of the relation between the master's tools and the master's house. Anticipating your talk today, we might say that our experiments in refusal become performative rather than steps in a larger arc of world building. Please join me in welcoming Bonnie Honig to Berkeley.
Thank you. Can everyone hear me? Can you hear me in the back? Yeah? Okay, great. That was such a lovely introduction, Stephen, and I want to thank you for it and for the invitation to be here with you. I've been reading Stephen's book and have some quotes from it as well, but I'm not going to start with them right now. But we've been in the email conversation for a few days, and it's been lovely. I also want to thank everyone affiliated with the Townsend Center for making everything easy for me. It's been a wonderful visit already, and I'm really looking forward to our conversation today. I want to thank everyone for being here, and also the three panelists in attendance who are going to be commentators on this talk tomorrow. Excuse me. Okay, so the work I want to share with you today is part of a brand new project that revisits J.L. Austin's text, How to Do Things with Words. In How to Do Things with Words, which was lectures from 1955, was that good for everyone, that lighting? Okay. In How to Do Things with Words, lectures which were given in 1955, then published as a book in 1962, J.L. Austin coined the term performative, meaning words that do things and do not just describe things. Among Austin's examples of such words, whether spoken or written, are I do, as at a wedding, I promise, I bet, or I bequeath, as in a will. I want to recover what was lost and perhaps never fully appreciated in Austin's book of lectures, especially now that performativity has come to mean fake or insincere, as in, that's so performative. I don't think we need another word for hypocrisy, at least not as much as we need non-cynical ways to talk about politics and our obligations to one another. For that, I find performativity in its original Austinian sense useful, especially by way of Hannah Arendt's account of political action that appears in words. That's her formulation in the human condition, action that appears in words. Now, action that appears in words is Austinian performativity, doing things with words, though Arendt doesn't use the term performative, nor does she mention Austin. Arendt and Austin both rule out appeals to intent or inner motive when dealing with performatives or deciding their fundamental meaning. But Arendt also expressly maintains that speech action is non-sovereign. So this is not something that Austin addresses explicitly. The function of the faculty of promising, she says, corresponds exactly to the existence of a freedom which was given under the condition of non-sovereignty, unquote. And that, because of that non-sovereignty, is why she also highlights the speech act of forgiveness in the public realm alongside promising. If our actions are non-sovereign, which is to say unpredictable, contingent, performed in front of or with plural others, then we will need the stability of promising, but we'll also need the release that forgiveness brings. We may break a promise, though we value the friendship that led to it. Forgiveness allows us to go on together, even so. So here is a key quote from The Human Condition. Arendt says, "The price human beings pay for freedom and the impossibility of remaining unique masters of what they do, of knowing its consequences and relying upon the future, is the price they pay for plurality and reality, for the joy of inhabiting together with others a world whose reality is guaranteed for each by the presence of all." So what she's pointing to is the importance in her account of the human realm of action, of the separateness of persons, a key point for Stanley Cavell in his work as well. What allows for plurality to exist, what underwrites reality, is the separateness of persons. As separate beings, we're capable of engaging in validation, vindication, verification. All of these are possible and also necessary because we are non-sovereign. It's both an enabling condition and a condition that we have to meet. Now, Austin doesn't discuss forgiveness. It's a speech act, and yet it isn't one of his many examples of performatives. But it is one of Arendt's. To Arendt, forgiveness is both a kind of speech action and also what she refers to as a process of constant mutual release. So it's an action and a condition of action. Now, I've said that Austin doesn't discuss forgiveness and how to do things with words, and he also, as I've said, doesn't discuss sovereignty or non-sovereignty. It's not a question for him. But he does, I think, offer a directive to these topics. I refer here to Euripides' Hippolytus, the 5th century tragedy which Austin cites in the opening pages of How to Do Things with Words. He cites the line, in which Hippolytus seems to consider breaking a promise or an oath that he has made. And in so considering, Hippolytus says that he didn't mean it when he said it. I'll come to the specifics of the utterance at the end of the talk. But for now, I just want to say that Austin refers to this line ostensibly to reflect on whether we should think of performatives as binding only if we intend them. And he's thinking through the analytics of performativity. Austin decides, no, if you've said you promise, you promise, and saying you didn't mean it doesn't get you out of it. But since Hippolytus himself also decides not, in the play he also keeps his word, Austin is accused even by admiring readers of having got the play wrong, or perhaps even forgotten it. Else why would he castigate Hippolytus for considering breaking a promise when he never does? So I'm going to return to this puzzle at the end of the talk, but I will say here that such critics neglect the larger performative import of the citation, and that will be my focus for today. I read the reference to the Hippolytus in Austin as a defixio, directing our attention in certain directions, first to the experience of non-sovereignty, and then to the politics of forgiveness. Both of these are central to the play, as we shall see, and are said to be missing from Austin's account of language. Are they, though? Stanley Cavell notes that How to Do Things with Words cites the line from the Hippolytus in Greek, Cavell says, as if, quote, calling attention to itself, unquote, though Cavell only gives the play a passing reading. Now, the Hippolytus is the ship that launched 1,000 Phaedras, so even if you think you don't know it, you may actually be familiar with it. And I'll recall here some of the story, and then I'll share more things as the argument unfolds. In the play, Phaedra is overtaken by a desire so powerful that it undoes her sense of self-sovereignty. She lusts for Hippolytus, her stepson, and tries to maintain control by starving herself and keeping silent about her wayward desire. But these tactics fail her. In the end, realizing her secret is known by Hippolytus, she kills herself, hoping to neutralize him lest he tell everything to his father, also her husband, King Theseus, and this would discredit her son's ambitions of succession to the throne. She leaves behind a note that casts suspicion on Hippolytus, accusing him of assaulting her, which leads Theseus to curse Hippolytus to death or exile. In the end, the two men, father and son, learn the truth and confront the wrongs they have done or suffered together. Well, maybe they confront them. We'll see. So the two themes, sovereignty first, is in play here. Phaedra's non-sovereignty, her wild desire, is in fact paralleled by a man's very sovereign relationship to his self. Hippolytus has taken an oath to chastity, and as a devotee of Artemis, he is not tempted to break it. The second theme, forgiveness, is also in play in Euripides' Hippolytus. In the final scene between father and son, described by mid-century classicists as a great scene of conciliation, acknowledgement, and forgiveness, a son, Hippolytus, a bastard, never recognized by his father, Theseus, and his father, the king, who has betrayed his son through this non-recognition and disavowal, seem to come to terms. Today, I'm going to offer a reading of the play in which Phaedra is more controlled, sovereign even, than is assumed. And I'm going to argue that that final scene is not a romance of reconciliation, but an agon of forgiveness. I will argue that in quoting Euripides, Austin put in play questions of sovereignty and forgiveness that he seemed to neglect. Now, a controlled Phaedra and a fatal forgiveness are the products of reading Hippolytus as noir, by which I mean in accordance with the traits of film noir, in keeping with the practice of classical reception or reception studies. To motivate this interpretation, today I want to discuss first a 1945 film called Leave Her to Heaven, in which a Phaedra character, Ellen, is played by Jean Tierney, but really by her lips. You might have noticed that in the opening slide. Organs of speech and sex. Ellen stands out as above all resolute in place, so that's number one, she's a very sovereign character, desperately passionate. And in place of a fatal forgiveness, the film will offer a trial as a way out of the human wreckage that occurs in her wake. There are echoes then between the play and the film around that question of forgiveness and law. I won't get into that in the paper, but I'm happy to discuss that more in the Q&A. So first, let's talk about non-sovereignty. So I want to talk to you a little bit about both non-sovereignty and then forgiveness as they stand in Austin studies. Austin was criticized in the 1990s by queer theorists for that I do, his speech act of marriage example, which they argued harbored or installed a masculinist, heteronormative, and sovereigntist form of subjectivity. But in Austin, that I do, which is there and does do what they say, is also countered by another example, also mentioned repeatedly throughout the book, that of an ornery bull that may be about to charge and cannot be securely contained, not by fencing, not by spoken words, and not by written signage. You may recall Don Pedro says about marriage to Benedick in Much Ado About Nothing, in time the savage bull doth bear the yoke. Well, in How to Do Things with Words, the savage bull doth also break the yoke. I detailed this reading of words elsewhere, so I won't go into it further here, but my aim in that reading, I want to make clear, is not to defend Austin against the queer theory critique. My aim is to suggest that a queer reading of Austin is possible by way of the bull, which makes for a more agonistic, desperate, and resolved sort of sovereignty than that attributed to Austin in the 1990s. I advance that argument further here today by way of Hippolytus, in which not only non-sovereign desire, but also bulls feature centrally, as we'll see. Forgiveness is not Austin's express topic, but when Austin cites Euripides' Hippolytus in 1955, he triggers Knox's reading of the play, Bernard Knox's reading of the play from 1952, a reading which to this day frames the play's interpretive possibilities. Writing in a post-war world of broken men, Bernard Knox, the classicist, posits in the final scene of the play, quote, a moving serenity that comes from the two broken men who are left on stage. Now, Knox was a trained classicist reading in Greek, and I'm acutely aware that I am not. But that said, I see something else in the scene, a transactional calculation. The father's lifelong unreachability and the disavowed bastard son's armoring against it continues in this, their last scene together, and contra Knox are not triumphed over exactly. Father and son speak past each other, I will argue. The forgiveness that Knox sees, quote, as an affirmation of purely human values in an inhuman universe does not quite take place. Something else does. Maybe it's enough. When Knox published his article, The Hippolytus of Euripides, in 1952, Austin was working on what would become his 1955 lectures on performative utterance to appear in 1962 as How to Do Things with Words, which cited Hippolytus, but never considered forgiveness at all, and certainly not as a performative utterance, nor does he rule it out. In 1958, Hannah Arendt's The Human Condition did the reverse. She didn't comment on the Hippolytus, but she did theorize forgiveness in some detail. She didn't cite Knox or Austin, but she echoed Knox's humanist, forgiveness-centered reading of the Hippolytus when she called forgiveness a human miracle. And she extended the reach of Austinian performativity when she described forgiveness, in part anyway, as an action that appears in words. Now, the Hippolytus is about passion, its potentially destructive and maybe also improvisatory powers, and the possibilities of repair after rupture. Noir is the then contemporary genre that took up such issues most centrally. Noir films were likely screened at the local cinemas of Knox, Austin, and Arendt in the 40s and 50s. So although much of what follows in this lecture will be a new reading of Euripides' Hippolytus and why it matters to Austinian ordinary language philosophy and the politics thereof, I will begin with Leave Her to Heaven, as which I read as a noir reception of Hippolytus. So I'll just say a couple quick things about it and then I'll get into it in more detail. This 1940 film noir features Ellen Berent, a woman so committed to her passion that she lets nothing stand in her way. Utterly indifferent to social convention, Ellen is a Phaedra character, but where Phaedra lives for a while in keeping with the dictates of conventional femininity and tries desperately to maintain respectability before finally, as I'll argue here, giving in and crossing over, Ellen has crossed over from the get-go. Some critics call Ellen a femme fatale because she is a film noir protagonist who's willing to kill to get what she wants. But Lee Edelman considers her briefly in No Future, in a footnote, asking whether Heaven's Ellen might actually be what he calls a synthemosexual. I'm going to pronounce it that way, even though I know it's coming from Saint-Ome, and then, you know, but how else are you going to? Okay, maybe there's a way. I'm going with that. His term, synthemosexual, is his term for a figure of desire that is monomaniacal, illegible, queer, illegible, queer, and death-driven, outside the commensurations and remediations of the symbolic. One of Edelman's examples of such is the murderous anti-child misogynist Bruno in Hitchcock's Strangers on a Train. Bruno's demise is the price of the daily ongoingness of reproductive futurism, Edelman argues. In the end, Edelman decides that Ellen Berent, though driven by obsessive love, is more femme fatale than synthemosexual because she remains somehow socially legible, he says, presumably because she's straight and striving for satisfaction. I will here, with and against Edelman, make the case for Ellen Berent as a synthemosexual in order to ask whether Euripides' Phaedra is one too. It seems unlikely, since Phaedra dies of shame, so it is assumed, whereas the synthemosexual is a shameless character, of course. But Euripides gives us reason to so assume, it's true. She has no other, at the same time though, she has no other moves left to secure her honor other than suicide. But what if in dying she not only manipulates events and creates a cover story, in other words, acting shamefully and hoping for to secure a future for her sons, but also manages to secure for her passion itself a freer and more authentic passionate existence? So I'm going to try that reading on you today. But first, why would it matter? It matters partly because of Stanley Cavell's critique of J.L. Austin. Cavell proposes amending Austin's itinerary, adding passionate utterance to Austin's performatives. Passionate utterances, Cavell says, are the words said by a person seeking to make themselves intelligible to another, with whom they are in relationship, in a way that is fundamental to who they are. So the exemplary utterance here would not be the "I do," it would be more like the "do you love me," or "I can't go on without you," or something like that. Cavell says that passionate utterance and intelligibility fix a catastrophe, that's his term, in Austin's theory, which is his neglect of desire and self-revelation in language. But in film noir, femme fatale reject intelligibility. For these women, the price of intelligibility in the ordinary of patriarchy is subservience in social roles and responsibilities. So opacity is their preferred register of communicative action. Illegibility, their freedom. Take, for example, Leave Her to Heaven's Ellen, a mixed-gender, gender-bendy femme fatale who is fundamentally socially illegible and fights to stay that way. As we'll see, her worst violence occurs whenever social legibility creeps up on her, as it has a habit of doing. And that, to respond to Edelman, may be what distinguishes female from male synthemosexuality, straight from gay. The former are more vulnerable to conformity creep, a susceptibility to momentary lapses that then requires adamant reassertion of purpose and overcorrection, of course. So, one last thing before I turn to Heaven in more detail, and then to the Hippolytus, and then back to Arendt and Austin and Cavell. I want to say that Ellen Berent is not only a femme fatale, if Edelman is right, and or a synthemosexual, if I am right. She's also something of an ordinary language philosopher. Her startling skills of Austinian analysis show up when she breaks up with her fiancé, Russell Quinton, played by Vincent Price. And this, I'll quote from now, will be their final spoken exchange. "Russell Quinton, I loved you. Ellen Berent. That's a concession. Russell Quinton, and I'm still in love with you. Ellen Berent, that's a tribute. Russell Quinton, and I always will be, remember that. Ellen Berent, Russ, is that a threat? With the words concession, tribute, threat, Ellen turns these statements from possible constitutives, mere descriptions of feelings, to Austinian performatives. In so doing, she also surgically dismantles their possibly Cavellian passionate power. As Ellen cannily catalogs what normal people say and how they mean it, we see her access to the ordinary is rather formal and dispassionate. It is as if Ellen is, like Phaedra, living in a foreign land, still feeling her way around and somehow passing for human. So, approached as a reception of Hippolytus, John Stahl's Leave Her to Heaven, which is the first noir to be filmed in color, by the way, plays with classical references. These norm the mysterious Ellen into conventional gendering. She's called an Amazon and a siren, both of which make a woman out of her, I want to say. There's also in the film's mise-en-scene some classical-looking, very kitsch statuary. And the film also shares many plot points and an ethico-political problematic with the Hippolytus. Marianne Doan summarizes the film. The female protagonist's, quote, excessive desire and over-possessiveness are signaled from the very beginning of the film, she says. But it is only later that her character is revealed to be the epitome of evil. Killing her husband's disabled younger brother, her unborn child, and ultimately herself in an attempt to brand or frame her cousin, also her adopted sister, same person, as a murderess in order to ensure her husband's future fidelity. Ellen Berent frames the cousin, the adopted sister Ruth, of wrongdoing in a letter accusing her, thus recalling Phaedra's postmortem entrapment of Hippolytus. Now, Doan's words, the epitome of evil, point to Edelman's synthemisexual. For Doan, though, Ellen is a femme fatale. But some critics disagree about that because, unlike the classic femme fatale, there's no monetary gain at stake for Ellen. This is another departure from femme fatalism, which points in the direction of Edelman. Ellen has plenty of her own money, and she even begs Richard Harlan, her new husband, played by Cornell Wilde, to stop working. She wants to support them both so that he can adore her without distraction. This is just one of many times Ellen proposes that she take the conventional male role and he the feminized one. That desire is also visually communicated by way of her very broad-shouldered costumes designed by Tierney's then-husband, later ex-husband, Oleg Cassini, as well as her mannish stride and her utter imperviousness to others. She just does what she wants. I've called it mannishness, but maybe it's just a broad indifference to social norms. As her over-the-top costuming shows, this is what she wears on the train. Ellen is not living in the same world as everybody else. She seems to be starring in her own movie. Now, Bernard Knox says the Hippolytus differs from most tragedies in which human's inflexible purpose is a straight line. In the Hippolytus, by contrast, the character's purpose is a zigzag, he says. Indeed, in no other Greek tragedy do so many people change their minds about so many important matters, says Knox. But we may get a different insight into Phaedra from Heaven's Ellen, since Ellen also zigzags, not because she changes her mind, but because she's willing to do anything to get the one thing she wants, Richard, her husband, all to herself. Even if it means wearing this. Somehow this peasant outfit, to my eye, lampoons the ill-suited femininity to which she assumes she is fated by her devotion to Richard. Ellen plays devoted carer for her very young brother-in-law, Danny, whose youth and infirmity, he's recovering from polio, put her in the role of mother to him and him in the Hippolytus role of stepson to her. Later, she'll dispose of Danny when he becomes inconvenient. I want to say that Ellen commits this murderous violence without batting an eye, but really we can't be sure since she puts on her sunglasses as she watches Danny drown. Ellen can play at gestation, but when she feels a rival about to emerge, as when an increasingly independent Danny knocks on a shared bedroom wall to say good morning as she's trying to initiate sex with Richard, or later when she's pregnant and the baby in utero begins to move, Ellen makes clear she wants no future and no maternalism. Ellen's commitment to her passion gives us insight into Phaedra. For both characters, self-commitment means moving beyond the human in ways that are called heroic when men risk it. I'm thinking here of Knox's heroic temper. But in Ellen's determination to be loved as fully and totally as she loves, there is also monstrosity, according to the film. I personally adore it. In the film, and in the developing momism of its mid-40s production, I'm borrowing the term from Michael Rogan's work, Ellen's anti-maternal nature means she is a monster. Her depth of feeling, communicated throughout by the visual grammar of noir, stark light and shadow, storming weather, tempestuous movement, costuming so loud you can almost hear it talk, is only verbalized and languaged towards the end when she finally confesses all to her husband. It seems to be a relief to her to tell, and there is in the telling no sign of guilt or conscience. But can Richard love her knowing the truth about her? In Cavellian terms, that would be what Ellen seeks, to be known and still loved. She seems to think Richard might get her if she explains that he might love her if he knows the truth about her. Is it a spoiler if I say no, he won't? Cavell says in a passing comment about Phaedra in the Hippolytus that she seeks to make herself intelligible to others. Quote, Phaedra's inability to keep her passion to herself in the first place, Cavell says, alluding to the fact that she shares her secret with the nurse, thus risking betrayal, may suggest calling this play a tragedy of expressiveness or of the desire for intelligibility, unquote. So that's directly opposed to the death-driven desires of Edelman's Synthemosexual, who does not seek legibility. That's one of the pivotal theoretical interpretive points in play here. In this way, saying this about the desire for intelligibility, Cavell affiliates Phaedra with his second invented film genre, the melodrama of the unknown woman, while he also plants the seeds of what he will call later, almost a decade later, passionate utterance, a kind of speech act that seeks out intelligibility. Austin neglected to catalog it, Cavell says, but passionate utterance is a performative that puts, quote, a relationship as part of my sense of identity or of my existence more radically at stake, unquote. Ellen's confession is a speech act. It may be a passionate utterance. It performs what looks like the desire for intelligibility, but it is radically unintelligible. Ellen tells Richard she killed Danny because she wanted to be alone with Richard. He cannot make sense of that. Who could? There will be a trial. I pass over it and so much else. But the trial, I will just say, somehow lands on a subtle verdict that offers ideological support for the use of law as an instrument of post-war reconstruction. The Nuremberg trials began 1 month before this movie was released in 1945. I should have checked by before now. Is everyone following well? It's clear? Okay. I can start over, but. Okay. Inspired by Heaven, a noir narration of the Hippolytus, mise-en-scène might go like this. Imagine this is a Humphrey Bogart voice you're hearing. Phaedra has left the big city, Athens, for the small town, Trozen, dragged along by her husband. Theseus is waiting for the right moment to return to the city he ruled until he was challenged by rival kin whom he slaughtered. He's been hiding from that blood guilt in Trozen, but he's now left to consult the oracle at Delphi about when he might return to Athens. With Theseus away looking for absolution and Trozen offering fewer distractions than Athens, Phaedra lights on Hippolytus, Theseus's illegitimate son. Raised in Trozen and now for the first time proximate to his father's family, Hippolytus is sworn to chastity, a sign of his devotion to Artemis, goddess of the day and the hunt, who belongs to nature, to the bees and the fields, and to daylight. Aphrodite, her antagonist in this play, is the goddess of night, divine avatar of noir. She curses Phaedra with a passion for Hippolytus to teach Hippolytus a lesson about the devotion owed also to the knight. Now, ample attention has been given in the critical literature to the machinations of Aphrodite, the nurse in the play, and Phaedra, and to Phaedra's shame. Less noted is how Phaedra's passion recalls her to her family line, a line of humans and bulls, as it happens. Phaedra refers to the story but doesn't wholly retell it. Her mother, Pasiphae, was famously gripped by passion for a white Cretan bull and conceived the Minotaur with him, which she later birthed. Morwood, the classicist, says, quote, the Minotaur, half man, half bull, was the result of her monstrous union, unquote. This means the Minotaur and Phaedra are half siblings by virtue of a shared mother. That is why Aphrodite picked out Phaedra for the passion fever that would topple the Artemis-loving Hippolytus from his high horse. As Froma Zeitlin points out, Aphrodite finds in Phaedra a willing accomplice. In her great speech, which I read as performative and perhaps also as passionate utterance, since it alters our sense of Phaedra and puts everything on the line, Phaedra turns to her bull lineage to account for her suffering. Caught in the storm of a different fate than to be human queen to human sons who will inherit their father's patrimony, confessing the truth of her situation to the nurse, Phaedra says, quote, oh, my poor mother, what a love you fell into, unquote. The nurse gets the point, but they miss the message. You mean her lust for the bull? No answer. Phaedra moves on to Ariadne, oh, my sad sister, wife of Dionysus, thus naming her brother-in-law, the god also known for appearing as a bull. The nurse then asks, why talk old family scandal? Answer, because Phaedra is next in line, and third me, she says. The scandal isn't over. Where is this going? Asks the nurse. And Phaedra replies, quote, to where our sorrows began long ago. Her bull lineage helps account for the passions that now overtake her. Everyone knows Phaedra's family lore, including Hippolytus, who shows it when he fantasizes about a city without women, where babies can be purchased at the market or temple, or failing that, a city in which households keep women in cages, their only company, quote, animals with bites but no speech, unquote, so that women, quote, can neither talk to anyone nor get a response from others, unquote. This is a life without intelligibility, without performativity, a life with bulls, perhaps. To readers now, Hippolytus' fantasy is a shocking, if sadly familiar, monologue of misogyny, but an audience of 5th century men would have laughed uproariously to hear it, and they would not have missed the joke's purpose. The fantasy enters the illegitimate Hippolytus into Athens' myth of autochthony, in which, as Leroux points out, quote, the originary kinship bond is of those who individually have their own father, while collectively they share the same mother. If all share the same mother, then as a category of birth, bastardry disappears. Phaedra, for her part, tries to protect her son's patrimony. If she hides her passion to maintain outward appearances, it is because she is focused on the future, more femme fatale in this way than synthemosexual, it seems. Bernard Knox says that Phaedra vacillates. She zigzags, he says. She's no straight liner. But as I've been saying, read alongside Heaven's Ellen Berendt, Phaedra emerges as a female synthemosexual, death-driven, but plagued also by false starts and missteps that require correction and overcorrection. Knox says also that Phaedra invokes her mother and her sister as examples of, quote, unhappy love, unquote. But I think we're talking about someone who slept with a bull and birthed the Minotaur. But I think she invokes them as women who took what they wanted and crossed the line of human animal, just as she crosses, I think, from femme fatale to synthemosexual, where she, in effect, joins them, her mother and her sister, to become bull. I think that's a straight line, a return to her family line. Now, Theseus returns finally to find his wife dead. He believes Phaedra's written lie that Hippolytus assaulted her, and his anger lands on Hippolytus as Phaedra has directed it too. Theseus quickly condemns the illegitimate Hippolytus to death or exile, calling on his own father Poseidon to see to it. It is no sooner said than done. Hippolytus submits to his fate. He prepares to exile, and as he steers his charioted horses by the sea, A wild bull rises from the water, frightening the horses and thwarting their efforts to get away, blocking them at every turn. Finally, the chariot crashes, and the desperate horses take off, dragging Hippolytus behind them. And entangled in the reins, his body is dragged on the rocks, torn open and battered until nearly dead. That's Rubens' painting, Death of Hippolytus, and one of the things that art historians point out about it is that in the sky you can see that although it's daylight, night is taking it over, which is Aphrodite, I would argue, triumphing over Artemis in that way. This wild charging bull is assumed by commentators to be sent by Poseidon, or perhaps to be Poseidon. The sea is Poseidon's domain, and Theseus has called on Poseidon, who is his father, directly to punish Hippolytus. But in the zig and the zag of the bull's chase, might we detect the once vacillating, now bull-bitten Phaedra, rebirthed by the sea, now freed of the gestational destiny to which Hippolytus in his fantasy tied Phaedra and all women. In sum, through the noir lens provided by Heaven's Ellen, we can see Phaedra as possessed of synthemosexual self-commitment, and we're led to reckon anew with the final scene of the play. So I haven't seen this, but there was at the Edinburgh Arts Festival a paired showing of both a Phaedra, that's Benjamin Britten's, and the Minotaur, A New Dance, and so I just wanted to share that with you. I think it's from just last summer. Okay. So until now, we've been reading the play in terms of thinking about Phaedra as a very sovereign and self-possessed character who appears non-sovereign and obsessed. But thinking of her as becoming bull allows a different reading. So now the last scene of forgiveness. Thus far, we have seen the Hippolytus explores life lived at the edge of intelligibility by way of Hippolytus, a bastard with freeborn thoughts, as the nurse says about him, and via Phaedra, a foreign-born queen perched on the line of human-animal in a patriarchal social order. The bull, in Austin's How to Do Things with Words, has become a synthemosexual figure when read alongside Phaedra, whose passion, given her kinship context, can be read as a kind of becoming bull. Until Phaedra arrives and Theseus leaves Trozen, Hippolytus was able to live as if he could control contingency. He is an oath keeper who swears his way into an existence almost without women, and with Phaedra gone, he ends in a household of only men, which, as we have seen, is the stuff of his dreams. It's his very own Back of the Moon. That's the name in Leave Her to Heaven of Richard's retreat in Maine. It's called Back of the Moon, where he and a man named Thorne, whom Ellen mistakes for the help, have spent time together for years raising Danny, and it's the place where Danny dies. Now, oath-keeping works well for Hippolytus for a while, but forgiveness, also a performative speech act, doesn't come easily to him, and this means that the resolution so many see in the play never quite occurs. The final scene in the Hippolytus is conventionally read as a scene of forgiveness, paternal recognition, and filial love. A fragile human existence is affirmed against the monstrous powers of the gods. Something like Cavell's passionate utterance seems to be in play when, as one classicist says, this is Harry Avery, father and son are now, quote, fully revealed to each other, Hippolytus in his purity and narrowness, Theseus in his guilt and sorrow, unquote. By contrast, I see the final scene's filial forgiveness as at best half-hearted and certainly forced. Theseus is asked repeatedly to cushion his son's suffering, but he will not let Hippolytus go. He cruelly prolongs things for long enough to get what he wants, harvestable words of forgiveness that might just satisfy gods and men enough to release Theseus from yet another blood guilt. Can everyone still hear? Is that not bothering you? Okay. The scene between father and son begins after a scene between Theseus and Artemis. The goddess confronts Theseus with his role in bringing about Hippolytus' death. Theseus rushed to judgment, Artemis says, quote, Thank you. You did not stop to consider your son's oath, meaning Hippolytus swore to Theseus that he didn't assault Phaedra, or consult the seer's words. You didn't test his case or allow time for investigation. Instead, you cursed your son and caused his death. So look at what she lists: considering, consulting, testing, investigating, all human practices of deliberation and judgment known in Athens at the time and presupposed as the sources of the intimations of the will tracked by Vernon. They may or may not reveal the truth of such practices, but they do slow sovereign decisionism, and this allows time for the truth to out, says Artemis. Artemis is indifferent to their differences, seers, trials, it's all the same to her. The point is they take time. It's not about their revelatory powers, but their power to buy time. Theseus listens, he sees his wrong, and says he wants to die. Not so fast, says Artemis. What you did was terrible, but you can still find forgiveness. Theseus will here recall Cavell's Lear, who hides his face from his beloved offspring, comes to believe a treasonous falsehood about her, then pronounces, without due deliberation, sentences of exile and death that he will later rue. Cavell suggests that if Lear cuts short the time of deliberation, it is in order to avoid the vulnerability that is the experience of being truly seen by others. This is Cavell's avoidance of love, and it is party to the crime of skepticism, which worries about the problem of other minds without seeing that the solution to it is precisely other minds, the separateness of persons that Arendt calls plurality, and that in Cavell inhibits projection. For Theseus, the problem of the other's mind has now become the question of Hippolytus. At the end of their scene together, Theseus will say to his dying bastard son, quote, beloved, how noble you are revealed to your father, unquote, thus seeming to reject the social niceties that once left Hippolytus out of the family circle. This is why most critics read this scene as a father-son reconciliation, but Artemis has ordered Hippolytus to forgive his father. Hippolytus does not do so, at least not right away, and characteristically, Theseus will try to hasten things along, and then failing that way to get what he wants, he will deepen and prolong Hippolytus' suffering to extract the words he craves. All of this violates the norms of forgiveness theorized by Maisha Cherry in Failures of Forgiveness, which require that forgiveness be voluntary, not ordered, and that it be offered only when the wronged is ready, not on another's timeline, nor at their behest. Cherry outlines in chapter 5 of her book the race politics of forgiveness, noting how forgiveness is preemptively demanded, and therefore itself preempted, by mainstream US journalists who confront Black victims of white violence too soon, with the question, can you forgive him? Some say a seemingly willing yes, though the bodies of their loved ones are not yet cold. For those who say no, efforts are made to extract their forgiveness. When do you think you might be ready? It's a macabre ritual, a keen weapon in America's artillery of racism, drawn out in the battle to neutralize the claims of those wronged, a way to cast them in white supremacist context as illegitimate heirs to or claimants of the thrones of democracy. Here, forgiveness becomes a technique of domination, not a ceremony of repair. This is Cherry. What inference can Black victims reasonably draw from these forgiveness requests, given the US racial past and present and the request's quick, lopsided nature? For many, the answer is that these requests seek relief from white discomfort, release from moral action, and superficial repair. Instead, Cherry says, ask, what do you want to tell us? What can we do for you? What do you want to have happen? Cherry's analysis helps make sense of the final scene of forgiveness in the Hippolytus. After Theseus learns the truth of his son's innocence, Hippolytus is brought in. He is barely alive. The chorus announces his arrival, and Hippolytus describes his suffering in detail. I'm not going to read all of it, but he's in agony. I'm wretched, disfigured by the unjust curses of an unjust father. Pain courses through my head, spasm through my brain. He tells his servants, be careful when you touch my body. Lift me with care, be careful. And then pain upon pain comes over me. He calls himself a poor wretch, begs to be finished off, finish me off in my misery, wishes he could put himself to death. And then Artemis greets him, and he responds with love. And together they talk about his sad state, his coming death, and she reveals to him Aphrodite's role in all of it, noting that it was his devotion to Artemis that angered Aphrodite. This moves Hippolytus finally to compassion, not for Phaedra, but for his father, since he sees the random hand of divinity at work in their homosocial tragedy. "I begin to grieve for my father's misfortune," he says. Then, as the details unfold, he adds that he also feels pity for Theseus. It's only now that Theseus joins the conversation. And he does so not to ask after Hippolytus, but to focus on himself. "I'm finished, my son. Life holds no pleasure for me now." To which Hippolytus says, "Despite your fault, I suffer more for you than for myself." They go back and forth, father and son, in their laments until Hippolytus says he wishes he could curse the gods. And then Artemis stops their talk. She avows she will avenge her beloved Hippolytus with unerring arrows. And she now tells Theseus to take Hippolytus in his arms. So she says vengeance is not for humans, it's for the gods. Forgiveness is for humans and not for the gods. "Take him in your arms," she says to Theseus. "Hold him close, for though unwittingly, you killed him." "It is natural for men to fall into error when the gods will it." So does Theseus do what she has commanded? Does he hold Hippolytus close? I don't think so, because the request will be repeated several times through the scene. Next, Artemis addresses Hippolytus and says, "Don't hate your father. This is your destiny to die like this. I have to go. I'm not allowed to see people die." She leaves. And then Hippolytus bids Artemis farewell, and then he says, quote, "At your request, I end my quarrel with my father, obedient to your command as always." At your request. Hippolytus has always used Artemis as a shield. Here he seems to give the requested forgiveness, but invoking Artemis, as he has done throughout his life, he also screens himself from his father. "At your request, I end my quarrel with my father," makes the forgiveness offered come not from Hippolytus, but from Artemis. Is that enough for Theseus? He will not think so. And in any case, even now, Hippolytus distances himself from his father, who has still not taken up his son as asked. How do we know? Because of what Hippolytus says next. "Darkness begins to steal over my eyes. Hold me, father, lay my body straight." Hippolytus repeats Artemis's earlier instruction, "Hold me." It seems Theseus is not holding him. Does he do it now? I don't think so. Still not holding Hippolytus. Indeed, I imagine, just as it's staged here by the National Theater of Greece, Theseus walking away from his son at this moment towards center stage. Theseus calls attention to his own troubles. He seems concerned that something short of forgiveness has been offered. "Oh, my son, what are you doing to me?" he says. "Oh, misfortune." Hippolytus says he can see the gates of the underworld, a sight he surely welcomes given his profound suffering. But Theseus calls him back. "Wait," he all but says. Quote, "Are you leaving me with hands defiled?" Unquote. Hippolytus now addresses his father directly. "No, I acquit you of this murder," unquote, meaning let me go. Recall, every second that goes by is more torturous pain for Hippolytus. This is an ordeal, a trial by suffering. But Theseus delays again. He doesn't yet have what he wants. Theseus, "What are you saying? Do you release me from this blood guilt?" Recall, he already has a blood guilt. That's why he's entrosen in the first place. Finally, Hippolytus says, "Yes." But now he goes back again to invoking Artemis as witness, he says, as a shield, I'd say. He enlists her, as he has always done, to insulate himself from paternal abandonment and projection. He withholds from his father what his father, Lear-like, withholds from him. This final avoidant compliance is enough for Theseus, just as the speeches of Goneril and Regan were enough, sadly, for Lear. It may be only now that Theseus takes up his son's body. Several lines have passed since he was first asked to do so. In the universe of a young life, it is a yawning gap of time. He now says the words that warm interpreters' hearts, "Dear son, how noble you have shown yourself to be to your father." But what is this nobility? It so moved Bernard Knox, recall. Was Hippolytus noble to resist Phaedra, who didn't interest him? Was he noble to forgive his cursing father who wronged him because Artemis told him to? or noble to endure long enough to produce finally the words that Theseus craves to hear. The two exchange warm words now, and Hippolytus says, quickly, cover my face with your robe. Quickly? Because death is coming, presumably, but maybe also quickly, because Theseus has shown himself to be slow to tend to his son. The chorus closes the play with praise for the great suffering of great men, as if the suffering of these two men is equal, as if Phaedra is nothing. Vengeance has been removed from the human realm, not as in Aeschylus by transforming and burying the Furies, but by ridding the city of Phaedra, the bull queen, and reserving vengeance for the gods. It's often observed by classicists that the final scene of father-son forgiveness in the Hippolytus happens after the two goddesses leave the stage, thus underwriting the tragic humanism of mid-century classics. But it is also a scene of homosocial forgiveness, and it happens over Phaedra's dead body. Phaedra's bullish desire, which is too much, enables a male reconciliation, which is too little. Stanley Cavell turned to mid-century American cinema's talkies to seek figures of democracy. He located democracy's promise in the ordinary's conversations of comic remarriage, not in the dramatic femicides of noir. Hence his remarking Phaedra's quest for intelligibility, but not her suicide. Hence his attraction to Ibsen's Nora in A Doll's House, but not to Hedda Gabler. My claim, reading not just Hippolytus, but Austin too as noir, and Austin's Bull as the synthemosexual of words, is that this was a wrong turn. A possible, maybe actual femicide is always there in the comic remarriage that is one facet of Cavell's American Ordinary, and Austin's reference to the Hippolytus on this reading is his tell. Okay. Recently, the intricacies of Austinian linguistic philosophy have crossed to the public stage of US politics. In the fall of 2023, Mickey Whithoff, the mother of Ashley Babbitt, who was shot by police at the US Capitol during the January 6th attack, gave a rabble-rousing speech in which she said, quote, Nancy Pelosi belongs at the end of a rope, unquote. She hastened to add, quote, these are not threats, unquote. Threatening a public official could get a person in trouble. Quote, I said they deserve it, she added, not that I'm going to do it, unquote. Thus recalling Ellen Barron's triptych, concession, tribute, threat. Here it is reordered, threat, concession, tribute. What is said, unsaid, then re-said. When Austin quotes Hippolytus, it is to denounce that sort of let out. Hippolytus has sworn an oath to the nurse to keep the secret of what's wrong with Phaedra, if only the nurse will tell him what it is. Then he hears the secret that Phaedra lusts for him, and he says, I must tell my father. But you can't, the nurse says. You promised. You took an oath. Hippolytus then says, my tongue swore too, but my heart did not. Austin takes a few pages to discuss that notion. Can promises or oaths be voided by reference to intent? Austin eviscerates the idea. It is, he says, a classic expression of a bad idea. Grammatically, this would mean that performatives have become constatives, as if the speech act is just a describer of an inner state. But he lodges a moral objection, too. It would give an alibi to moralists like Hippolytus who seek a let out. It would give the bigamist with an excuse for his I do, and the Welsher a defense for his I bet. Better, Austin says, just to go with the common saying, our word is our bond. When Maisha Cherry says it is necessary for us to retrain ourselves, she sounds like Austin and continues his work. It has long been necessary to retrain ourselves. We can see this all the more pointedly when we consider Hippolytus as noir in the context of American racial politics. The story is all too familiar. A young man whose word is his bond is left out of the political family circle, falsely accused of sexual assault, disbelieved when he protests his innocence, keeps his word and never discloses what has been disclosed to him, wishes aloud that the house could talk and bear witness itself, a theme in Hippolytus and Morrison and Baldwin, wishing that and never disclosing what has been disclosed to him, though it could maybe save him, but he is unlikely to be believed, lives by the common saying, our word is our bond, though others do not. And though he is not acknowledged as part of the hour of our bond and is made martyr to an idea that does not share itself with him, then sentenced to die, and though he begs for death, his suffering is that profound, is then made to linger long enough to forgive those who wronged him and who never consider what they may owe him. If I were casting this play today, I would cast Hippolytus as black, and I would join classicist Nancy Worman's reading of the pierced and porous bodies of tragedy in her book Tragic Bodies to the politics of the flesh advanced in recent years by Hortense Spillers and others. Hippolytus, too, goes from person to flesh. In short, I am suggesting that Bernard Knox's romanticization of the Euripidean scene between father and son, founding father Theseus, and disavowed bastard son Hippolytus, can be read not just in the post-war humanist context he shares with Austin and Arendt, each in their own way, but rather or also in the context of the American politics of race with which Bernard Knox was well acquainted, as he makes clear in a 1994 review essay titled In Another Country. Commenting on several new books on the Spanish Civil War, in which he had himself fought, Knox says this. Oh, sorry, forgot that slide. Well, I said it all. Sorry about that. This is what Knox says. The Lincoln Brigade was unique in the history of American armies for its complete absence of racial discrimination. African Americans, this is him saying this, served in the ranks, and one of them, Oliver Law, was in command of the Lincoln Battalion when he was killed in battle. The first black soldier to command white American troops. Not for another decade in a world war did the process of racial integration get a start in the US Armed Forces with Truman's directive in 1948, unquote. Knox, later in the review, also recalls the racial segregation of soldiers on board ship to Europe just a few years later during the Second World War, in which he also fought. Knox says, I was one of many thousands of men packed into the Queen Elizabeth for the Atlantic crossing in February 1943. He only discovered there were black soldiers on board when midway through the voyage, a boat drill forced everyone to the deck. It took 2 hours, which was way too long, and as, quote, the captain's voice exhorted us to do better than that next time, we heard the clatter of steps on the main staircase and into the sunlight, blinking and rubbing their eyes. Came a battalion of black soldiers of the quartermaster's corps. No one had any idea that they were on board. They must have been loaded first, kept in the ship's bowels just above the keel. Knox then reports with a sense of triumph, quote, nobody could have imagined at that moment that in just about 50 more years, a black soldier would become chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, that the United States Army would finally catch up with the Lincoln Brigade. Unquote. It is as if, in Knox's mind, the country had internalized the captain's exhortation to do better the next time. In this context, Knox's reading of the Hippolytus reflects or projects not just, one, a humanist faith in the power of forgiveness, which accepts Theseus's innocence, but also, two, the white innocence that would drive James Baldwin to ever greater depths of despair over the next decades, as if Theseus kept winning and Hippolytus kept dying over and over again. Quote, but it is not permissible that the authors of devastation should also be innocent. It is the innocence which constitutes the crime, Baldwin says in Native Son. Theseus is not fully innocent, of course, but Knox's redemptive reading makes him so, or allows him to be made so, by what Hannah Arendt calls the human miracle of forgiveness. This is not because of any theology that she calls it a miracle. The miracle of forgiveness for Arendt is that it is a spanner in the works of causality. It feels like freedom because it undoes the destiny and destination to which it sometimes seems we are all inevitably and inexorably bound. Where actions' impacts seem to have a process-like quality that cannot be denied, forgiveness, Arendt says, opens up new possibilities. The act of forgiving can never be predicted, she says. It's the only reaction that acts in an unexpected way, The only reaction which does not merely react, but acts anew and unexpectedly, unconditioned by the act which provoked it, and therefore freeing from its consequences both the one who forgives and the one who is forgiven. The freedom contained in Jesus' teachings of forgiveness is the freedom from vengeance, which encloses both doer and sufferer in the relentless automatism of the action process, which by itself need never come to an end. Unquote. So forgiveness here does what Artemis does in the Hippolytus. It makes human vengeance unnecessary. It deprives the human realm of vengeance. The miracle of it is this: those who are attacked do not need to respond in kind. We can make a different choice. The surprise of it might open up a different, unpredictable future. But the surprise cannot do the work. The work has to be done for the sake of the surprise. This is why Baldwin says, quote, "Nobody else is going to save you. You've got to save yourselves." That is not his work. But this is. We have come to the end of a language, Baldwin says, and are now about the business of forging a new one, unquote. Or in Maisha Cherry's Austinian words, quote, "It is necessary for us to retrain ourselves," unquote. Thank you. So I can start. I can tell you what I think I have to do next. I'll just say this because I'd love to hear what people think about it, and then I'm also, it'll give you a minute to process questions if you have them. But I don't think that Cherry and Baldwin are occupying the same position at all. And I think that the fact that Cherry continues an Austinian style of analysis provides an opportunity to think through the reasons why and how exactly Baldwin and an Austinian analysis diverge. But the faith in the capacity to retrain ourselves, the substitution of good questions for bad questions, posits and postulates a kind of faith in the ordinary that Baldwin began with, but certainly didn't end with. So there's a kind of radical critique of that that I haven't yet developed because I'm still thinking about it, about its exact details, I mean. So. Yes?
I have what I'm sure is a blunt and...
I have what I'm sure is a blunt and probably flat question, so take both of those feelings. But I guess my question is, does feeling matter in forgiveness? That is, you know, when Hippolytus says that his tongue swore it, but his heart did not, there is one way of reading that. And then there's the way of reading that because he's told Artemis, to whom he has pure devotion, that he does in fact do as he promises Artemis. And I'm just wondering whether you have to feel the forgiveness for it to be real, or if the promise does, as Austin might suggest, the action, right? Does the speech act sort of solve the problem of feeling?
That's a great question. I don't want to, let's see. I don't want to think of the feeling as a problem, and I don't want to think of speech as the solution. I'm just going to sort of resist some of the framing for a minute to think with you and to say that it isn't clear either that Austin would license that way of thinking about it, as speech-centered as he's taken to be. Certainly what Cavell finds attractive in him is that he brings a world of moral and emotional life into being through language, even if he sometimes stops short, shorter than where Cavell would have liked him to. I had some discussion in an earlier draft of the paper about why Austin might have not talked about forgiveness, even though it seems a sort of obvious and interesting example of performative utterance. And what I was toying with there was the possibility that in our own culture, and his at the time too, it's very hard to talk about forgiveness without talking about sincerity. And he doesn't want sincerity to be the sort of secret anchor of performative utterance. And so it may be, you know, it's complete conjecture on my part, but maybe that looked to him like it was going to be more trouble than it was worth to work through that one by comparison with others that he did choose. But it's total speculation on my part. I think this is sort of still just thinking with your question, that's one of the things that I find really attractive in Arendt's work, because she absolutely, not in a subtle way, rules out psychological intention, motivation, all internalities. What matters is what's said, what's unleashed and sent out into the world. Of course, one of the reasons we care about sincerity is because we're hoping that it will indicate a fidelity to the speech after it's uttered, that it's not a manipulative or instrumentalized form of speech. But as that too is ruled out by Arendt, but what she's really fastened on is the idea that if we demoralize it, then it might be able to do things. It's a really how to do things with words kind of argument that's very Austinian in some ways, more so even than Austin's version. So I'm not, what I'm interested in the project is less adjudicating the question of sincerity than in thinking about the fatality of forgiveness, not in the sense that it's fatal, although I had a line in the paper somewhere that seems to have dropped out where Artemis is basically saying to Hippolytus, would it kill you to forgive your father, sort of the Jewish Greek goddess. But I think, the fatality of forgiveness in Arendt is that every action has its own fatality, but you don't know it, right? Action is released into the world, and I always think of it as like someone throwing a stone into a pond, and then there's ripple and ripple and ripple around it, potentially infinitely. And that's how she thinks about it. And the only thing that can stop all that rippling is another stone or another stone. And it'll change the arrangement of the rippling. And so for her, forgiveness is so precious, because it refuses the reactivity. I hope it's obvious why I chose that particular example to think with, but the fatality of forgiveness is that it's interruptive. It doesn't have any other destination secured to it than any other action could, because they're all free and they're all in a plural context. So there's no guarantee how it will turn out, but you can interrupt something that's already happened and hope to redirect it in a new way. But that, too, will require more and more work. I think the importance of Baldwin to this discussion, and I haven't done enough work on him yet to be able to speak, in detail about it, but the importance of Baldwin here is the idea that that he takes up, that I underlined in Arendt and Cavell as well. He gets it from other sources, his own sources, but the idea that we are separate people and that we cannot solve this problem for each other. Everybody is in it. Together and apart ourselves. It's a very, both to recur to the lovely introduction that Stephen gave, it's both a very pessimistic and at the same time potentially optimistic thought. So is that okay? Thank you. I don't know, Stephen, what to do. I see Catherine here, and there's also someone back there.
I have a question also about what the context of forgiveness is. But it seems to me that there are two very different things that you're talking about. One is the one you started with Arendt, which is its relationship to a promise, as in forgiving a debt, for example. That is, it's the opposite. It's the I release you from that promise kind of forgiveness. And the other is forgiveness for a wrong, where it's not really clear that it's in response to some other speech act. Mm-hmm. So those seem to me to be very, very different things. And could you say something about the two of them and which one is actually involved in the drama that you want to elucidate?
See if I can find the slide I didn't use. Yeah, so thank you very much. It's very useful to think with you about that. I think there's a couple of things going on in Arendt. Once you demoralize in the way that she does, you have to start thinking, well, okay, so how is it working? And you know, a couple of suggestions that I have for how to think about it. One is that it works more like Nietzsche's idea of just lordly dismissal. Like they don't, you know, I'm so powerful, what do I care? You know, just go on your way. But the other, which is an ethos, you know, like to act like you're so powerful and wrongs don't bother you and go on your way. You know, I mean, there's something about indifference that has a great moral attraction. But the other is debt forgiveness, which you mentioned, which in, you know, if you follow the sort of biblical requirement of Jubilee, that comes every 7 or every 49 years, just like Sabbath comes every 7 days. And, you know, that's when debts are released. They're not released, you don't have to want to, you don't have to love anybody, you don't have to forgive anybody, it's the time. and all, you know, all slaves are freed, slaves of debt are freed during the Jubilee year. So those are two possible ways of thinking about a kind of forgiveness that is either dismissing or like debt forgiveness structural, both of which release and sort of sidestep the question of intent or sincerity or moral judgment. It isn't just that it's because, so Arendt talks about action as built on these two practices of promising and forgiveness, which is why they come together. But when she talks about them, she doesn't limit them to each other. So you don't, even though I did invite this by saying, you know, when we break a promise, we want to still preserve the friendship, and forgiveness is what allows it. But forgiveness is also for all kinds of wrongs done, because everything that happens in the public realm happens, you know, because, you know, you might say something with all kinds of good intentions, but it goes in all kinds of directions. It's taken up by other people. They do other things with it. It causes all kinds of harm that you might not have anticipated. It may cause harm that you wanted to cause. You can't get involved in all of that. It's not normative with her. It's phenomenological. Politically, we don't involve ourselves in that. That might be a question for courts. It might be a question for relationships. But in politics, we sort of look for a way to go on together even after that's happened, and promising and forgiveness are what make that possible. So I don't know, that's just sort of the context that this question falls into, so I don't know if I answered you, if that's an answer. Is it an answer? Okay.
Thank you. I had some more questions about promising and forgiveness. So if I remember the human condition, at least in the rendition of them there, promising is the bond to the future. And so it can be broken. I mean, you can break your promise. It's a bond to the future. Of course, it can be broken. But as you're pointing out, forgiveness as a release can't be broken. I mean, you can't break a release because it's a release. But I wonder if... I believe Arendt says there, and I wonder how it affects your argument, that it's not just that forgiveness is, as you say, as you quote here, the constant mutual release, but that we can only act because we know that, and I think she even says there's an expectation of forgiveness. Yes. So forgiveness starts to look not as free and not as released. It becomes the expectation of forgiveness is what lets us act, because we know all the repercussions of what we might do, you know, all the unintended things. But that expectation of forgiveness starts to look almost like forgiveness is promised. So it's like future bound again. It's not even just release from the past. And I'm curious how that affects what you're saying about forgiveness. I mean, in the various contexts, certainly with regard to the Hippolytus and everything else, but also with regard to the, you know, the Baldwin, the racial, you know, scenes that you're evoking.
Thank you. So what she says is that promising and forgiveness are not the only actions that we perform in the public realm, but that they're the sine qua non of there being a public realm. So there has to be the capacity to bind ourselves together into a future, and there also has to be a capacity to release wrongs in a way that doesn't participate in a cycle of vengeance. That's what's really important. And so there is this, I don't know if she uses the word expectation, but this is what she means by sine qua non, that when you act in the public realm, that you have, that you know, as it were, that you're in a domain where you will be held to some account, but not to moral judgment. Historians will judge what you did. Stories will be told. They may not be the stories you would love to have told about you. You might want to give some thought to what you do and how you do it in order to, achieve what you would like to. Certainly the actions that she extols are ones that further promote and protect the condition of plurality and equality. So it's not like just do anything you want and you'll be forgiven. It's that the point of political action is to preserve the ongoingness of a public realm and practices of equality and plurality. So that's a really important part of the argument for her, is that, and one not to lose sight of. And to me, that comes newly clear by reading her alongside Cavell, who is not making exactly that argument at all, but both of them land on the importance of the separateness of persons to undo the temptation to either skepticism or nihilism, right? So that what you're doing matters, and how it matters is in terms of its capacity to support and promote these humanist conditions of coexistence. I don't think forgiveness is either past-oriented or future-oriented exactly. It's a commitment to not allow the cycle of vengeance to destabilize and to destabilize collective life. And so there has to be a way to put things to bed so that it doesn't go on endlessly. It's like the rippling pond thing. So that has to do partly with being, I liked what you said about how forgiveness is future-oriented. Often we think about it as past-oriented because we want to undo the wrong. But it's future-oriented in the same way that promising is, in a way, on Arendt's account of it. Because it's what makes it possible to go on together after a rupture. Yeah. Thank you. Oh, I've actually given away my right to choose. So Marty's up here. For the next one, maybe. Who's now?
Yeah,
okay, good.
Hi, thank you for that really interesting talk. I had two questions. One is that, your framing of forgiveness via Arendt, especially when you were answering Palomi's question as an interruption, as this force that is miraculous in so much as it seems to both exceed the bounds of selfhood and tether self and other in some kind of way, in so much as she says, it's a human miracle. It seems like a lift from the register of ordinary interaction. And I was thinking to myself when you were saying that sounds a lot like desire in the mechanism of that feeling, the throwing off a pebble in a pond, the ripples that are produced. So my first question was about, thinking about the possible symmetry between the forces of forgiveness and desire, and perhaps how that plays out in a drama like the one you described, where the consequence of desire in some way becomes the thing that is at stake to forgive. And my second question was, I was sort of wondering, I haven't read the play and I didn't know about it until today, but it made me think also about not just the bestowing of forgiveness, but the accepting of forgiveness, that is to say, forgiving oneself. And I guess I wondered, I got the feeling like in the play, the emphasis was so much on Artemis telling, what's his name?
Hippolytus
to forgive his father.
Yes.
And it seemed like what was taken for granted was that the forgiveness would be accepted that is, Theseus would forgive himself. So I also wanted to ask about that.
Okay, thank you. Oh, do you want me to take both together, or should I? Can I answer this first? Okay, I didn't know. Okay, thank you. So, it is a lift from the ordinary. I mean, what Arendt says about political action is that it's extraordinary. What I've presented you with today is a very Austinian reading of Arendt, which is, here are these speech acts, and we do them, and things happen. And I think that Austin helps us understand some otherwise quite opaque things in Arendt's account. But for her, what happens in the public realm is quite extraordinary. And what she's, because, I mean, now you can see it even more clearly than we could maybe in recent years, the stakes of undertaking a public appearance are very costly. And they're very costly in the sense of, you know, they may take away your livelihood. They may lose you your job. You may take a stand on principle and find your name on a list. And so those things are ways to sort of make clear and also raise the costs of principled political action. And Arendt says, you know, it might not be for most people. Those are costly things. And she also says, although I've talked about it individualistically, partly driven by the comparison with Austin, she also says that this happens in concert. One of the reasons we find the passion that she likes to talk about in the section on action is courage. One of the reasons we find courage is because we're in it with others. And there's a kind of, you know, one way to think about that, which I talked about in my refusal book, is that she's saying that when you act with others, you're prefiguring the possible world that you're orienting to, as if you are not confined to the existing world that you're in. And in that act of prefiguration is a kind of bridge from the realism of where we are to the utopianism of where we want to get. And courage is the passion that describes that, but it isn't just an individual trait. It's very much a kind of aspect of being together with others in common cause. So I find that quite a lift from the ordinary, to take your phrase, your beautiful phrase. And then the other thing I want to say to your second question is that what forgiveness is on her account that I also find attractive, but in an ordinary sense we all know it, is, I mean, anyone who's been in a long-term relationship has at some time or another surely just set aside a wrong because they'd rather go on together than litigate it endlessly. Right? And sometimes that's the wrong idea, sometimes it's the right idea, but everyone who's ever lasted more than a week in a relationship has done this. So that's, you know, that's the futural dimension. It's, you don't necessarily forgive it in the moralistic sense, you don't necessarily litigate it to a satisfying conclusion, you just decide it's less important than this thing that you're doing together. And, you know, Nicola Rowe, again, I had this material in a longer paper, I didn't discuss it today, but Nicola Rowe describes the conditions under which in 403 BC Athens returned from being an oligarchy to a democracy. And they did so by making everybody take an oath to not recall the terrible things that happened under the oligarchs. They also killed some of the oligarchs, which seemed like a really good idea at the time. And maybe it was, but what they committed to. It's so stark, actually, to read her book, The Divided City, in the context of our current politics, because what they committed to was to return from division, not by litigating everything endlessly, but by committing to not discuss it, which is another thing couples might be familiar with as well. We're just not going to talk about that anymore. So, and there would be no relitigating of lost causes, no flying flags, none of that stuff, because we're a democracy now, and those whole 7-8 years are just gone, you know? Now, it doesn't entirely work, but that was the idea. The idea was this amnesty for everyone except for a few of the leaders. And in return for that, everyone would agree to just let it go. Yeah. So it's in that sense, I think, that forgiveness is also working in Arendt. I think the Leroux account and the Arendt account are actually quite close there. Thank you.
If I understood your argument correctly, you were positioning forgiveness against sovereignty. Sovereignty as a kind of ingathering of decision-making power, and forgiveness as a kind of, let's say, intersubjective phenomenon, which does not have the kind of clustering of power in one pole. It seems to me, though, that there is in the practice of forgiveness in the political realm an important dimension of power, which is often institutional. In other words, the injured party can forgive, that's possible, but there is also a kind of diffuse non-injured party who has the power to pardon. You can see it also in the Catholic Church. The priest has the power to grant absolution for a sin, even though the sin was not committed against the priest. But in other words, the power to pardon that a governor or a president has is not because of the direct injury that's being forgiven, but rather because of the larger institutional context. And this, of course, is what Austin tells us about performatives, that when you say, I do, when you become married, it's only because there's somebody who is there presiding over it who has some sort of legitimacy creating the binding quality of the illocutionary or prolocutionary act. Mm-hmm. So I want to, in a way, ask you to fudge the distinction between sovereignty, power on the one hand, and forgiveness on the other, because precisely in the act of pardoning, they become conflated.
Okay, so the chapter after this is on pardoning, so I've separated them so that they won't be conflating. This is the forgiveness chapter. So, and I think it can be confusing to conflate them, as you yourself are suggesting. A book I've been reading lately is Sarah Beckwith's book on Shakespeare and the Grammar of Forgiveness, in which she traces the democratization, I want to say, she doesn't quite put it this way, of forgiveness from being what you've just described as you've described it, a property, a practice available to church or state through pardon, confession, and the rest, right? To becoming something that anyone can give to anyone else. Like, you don't need the intermediary anymore after Shakespeare's New Grammar, she argues historically. And so that's on my mind as I hear your question. I want to also say that in LaRoe's argument about the divided city, her claim is that there has to be, for that oath-taking to work, for the regathering of the ruptured polity together, there are penalties for perjury. So the reason everyone has to take an oath and not just agree not to bring up the old divisions anymore, but they have to take an oath, is because then if they break the oath, they can be put up on perjury charges. So there is a sense in which, on her account, she's not talking about forgiveness. She's talking about amnesty, and it has that political valence that you're asking about. It's not, and then the last thing I'll say is, it's not that I'm talking about sovereignty exactly. It's that I'm trying to make the argument that Austin, who seems to not be talking about sovereignty, is, and it comes from a strange location, which is the desire represented by the bull, that there's a kind of self-commitment and sovereignty in that bullish desire. And that's, you know, what I call, drawing on Knox, a kind of being a straight liner, you know, having a kind of, you know, heroic temper of your own. So the question of forgiveness, and most importantly in Arendt, is a question of non-sovereignty. Like, that's, I'm sorry, I've circled around to it, but the most important thing about both forgiveness and promising in Arendt is that they're non-sovereign practices. Remember, that's the importance of plurality and separateness of persons, right? You make a promise, you offer forgiveness, it's going to land where it lands, and then it's going to land with other people and other people and other people, and you're going to respond to how you're being responded to, and hopefully you're in concert with others. And you're in a, it's not about achieving sovereignty for her, nor is it about sovereign utterances. It's mutual, plural, unpredictable, contingent, and very challenging to get through all of that. But it's not sovereignty you seek, and it's not sovereignty that supports you in these efforts for her. And I'm drawn to her for these reasons. I mean, I think it's pretty clear when I talk about the separateness of persons and the implications of living in a context of plurality, what that means. I'm not sure we've ever lived it in terms of what it means. And in that sense, I'm very drawn by Baldwin for that reason. Like, what would it mean to actually live like this is what Baldwin is asking by the early 70s. The quotes that I offered you from Baldwin, many of them were from this interview that he did in 1973. So it's the late Baldwin mostly that I'm drawing on today, who is, you know, not optimistic about the possibilities, but very clear, I think, about the responsibilities that could get us anywhere other than just continuing to reproduce the same.
Sorry. Bonnie, thank you again. Tomorrow in this room at 5 o'clock, we'll be having a faculty panel where Mario Tello, Dora Zhang, and Marianne Constable will offer their responses to Bonnie's talk, and we'll sort of discuss the talk further. So thanks again.